Britain is home to 32 million sheep. And for centuries, we have relied on our four-legged friends for wool to knit with. But it was only in the 20th century that knitting rose from a humble craft to the height of popular fashion. Over six glorious decades, from the roaring 20s to the 1980s, knitting would become the staple of every wardrobe.
Well, I wonder if you've noticed the sweater that I'm wearing. It's, I think, just about the chunkiest sweater that I've ever seen.
Young and old, male and female, and in every style imaginable. From hand knits made from real wool, soft and fluffy, or a bit scratchy. But also smooth knitted fabric made on machines, and synthetic knits, colourful and even sexy.
You know where you are with knitting needles. There's something safe, secure, methodical, and at the same time creative.
During this golden age, the art of knitting would come to define Britain. In days of leisure, but also times of hardship.
We just knitted and got giggled and knitted and giggled some more, and it was good.
It's a craft that has captured our national spirit.
I think that knitting is particularly British because it's thrifty, it's hard work, but also it's great fun, it's quirky, it's about sharing, and it's full of humour.
This is the story of our nation, told through two needles and a length of yarn. A golden age of British knitting. For hundreds of years, the knitted jumper was a functional garment, a working-class staple, cheap to make, warm and practical, worn by the army, sailors and fishermen. One thing a knitted jumper was not was fashionable. All that was to change in the 1920s, with a new generation of bright young things who wanted to put the misery of the First World War behind them and begin a new age of fun and frolics. And it all started with one man. The pin-up of the age, the Prince of Wales.
This was the 20s. People were looking for colour, fun, and generally more relaxed living. I think the prince sort of embodied this youthful spirit, and so he was extremely popular as a prince. He was considered to be very handsome, although he was minute, and of course photography was getting better, so the newspapers carried reports on him, and everyone could go to the cinema and they would see news programmes of the prince on these royal tours that he went, and he really was a breath of fresh air, and people adored him.
On the 27th of September 1922, the Prince of Wales stepped out on the golf course at St Andrews in Scotland in front of a huge crowd. All eyes were on his outfit. Knickerbocker trousers stuffed into socks, and on his head, a cloth cap. But it was what he wore under his tweed jacket that was to cause a sensation. A Fair Isle jumper, later immortalised in a painting, with its bold geometric pattern, no one had seen a jumper quite like it in society, let alone on a prince. Made on a remote Scottish island and entirely hand-knitted, this was a fisherman's working garment, reinvented as high fashion.
It was quite startling to journalists and fashion commentators at the time, almost vulgar in its brightness and in the way that the knitwear offered a sense of informality that was quite shocking, but very, very chic. So what Edward really did was he brought the comfort and the functionality of knitwear into a fashionable context.
The prince's wardrobe choice was to put Fair Isle, a tiny remote island off the north coast of Scotland, firmly on the fashion map. In the 1920s, the islanders were flooded with new orders for their hand-knitted jumpers. But making a jumper was hard work. The whole process, from plucking the fleece to spinning the yarn, was done by hand.
Knitting was an income. It was a livelihood. It wasn't done as a hobby in the way that it might be done now. It was done to supplement the subsistence incomes that they had from farming and fishing. And so they would take every opportunity to knit, because it was very precious time to be spent, so they really had to knit as fast as possible. They could knit whilst walking along, and so they were never idle, and their hands were always working, whether they were walking, whether they were tending to flocks. So they were really doubly employed a lot of the time. And the knitting of the Fair Isle jumpers from the 20s became so fashionable. This was a real income for them.
Fair Isle has its own unique style. Hard learned and complex to do.
Oh, it's lovely knitted, it's so even.
I learnt to knit egg cosies. You got 3 and 6 pence each when you sold them, so that was the pocket money. I wouldn't say like four of us together, so.
Oh, yeah. Uh-huh.
It's not just an island tradition, but a family one. We have a fair bit of chance. Passed down generation to generation, mother to daughter.
Fair Isle knitting is a very clever way of actually creating very complicated colour patterns, but working just with two colours in a row at a time. What I'm doing is holding the two colours in my right hand. Alternately, I'm knitting 3 stitches at the cream and then 1 stitch with a sort of brown colour. 3 of 1 colour, 1 of the 2nd colour. In this row, and that will change row by row so that I can then create the colour pattern. The colour, which isn't being knitted at the time, it waits until I need it next, and then I have to knit that loop, and by bringing it forward it creates a strand. And it also makes the fabric very thick and warm and cosy, and that was something that in Fair Isle they really needed. And the first Fair Isle items were actually hats and gloves and scarves before they did sweaters.
After the prince, it wasn't just Fair Isle that became popular, but hand-knitted jumpers of every kind.
What you see in countless photographs of the 1920s of middle-class and lower-middle-class men is the mass adoption of knitwear. Jumpers and socks made at home with love become acceptable presents. So you suddenly see the man's wardrobe, the husband's wardrobe, the son's wardrobe transformed by this knitting craze.
And knitwear wasn't just about jumpers. There were knitted vests, long johns, and women's all-in-ones. chief of the knitted underwear industry was Derbyshire company John Smedley. With a history stretching back nearly 230 years, today it's the oldest factory in the world still in operation. John Smedley still makes some of its garments on knitting machines similar to the ones used for underwear in the 1920s. Operated by hand, machine knitting is a skill in its own right.
First of all, you have to set the width of the garment that you're starting at. That is done with the levers on the end. You can select widening, which is to widen, or narrowing, which is to narrow. Bar in, and we put weight on it. Then, on an outerwear garment, we would normally have probably 12 plain courses. So you would do 1, 2, 3, 4. That counts the courses. In a garment, you might have, say, 269 plain courses. A lot of knitters could actually keep count in their head, but you've only got to sort of let your concentration wander. You're thinking, oh, how many?
Some of the original underwear is still kept in the mill's archives.
One of the great advantages of being able to knit garments is that you can shape them to fit what we call fully fashioned fit. And Smedley's were doing that from quite early on. So you can see on these garments, you can see evidence of them shaping the leg or the arm or the body. And for the breast gauze, as they're called, you can see that they were capable of shaping the garment to fit. So this means that they're very comfortable. And of course, they have to be worn in combination with corsets. So something like this would sit very comfortably under that. And it did enable you, obviously, to have something that you could wash and change frequently because the outer clothes weren't washed or changed so frequently. And of course, these garments enabled people to survive in houses which didn't have central heating. When you're wearing a garment like this, there are certain practical details which have to be remembered. And right up until the 1920s, women wore undergarments with open gussets. They had long skirts, and for simple practicalities, you needed relatively easy access.
But the world of machine-knitted fabric was about to explode. The fine knit material so suitable for underpants and long johns had attracted the attention of a woman who would become one of the most famous designers in the world. Coco Chanel. The woman's wardrobe would never be the same again.
Coco Chanel, of course, is somebody who's really credited with bringing modern dressing for women to the fore. And she was very much about comfort and relaxation and wearable clothing. She worked with a lot of British knitwear companies to produce knitted suits and lots of jersey garments within her designs. Really, knitwear provided a revolutionary way of dressing because it meant that soft separates were available for the day and women were no longer constrained to tightly tailored and corseted garments. So it's really the beginning of the modern way of dressing.
Chanel was the first to introduce the idea of wearing jersey layers, which would become the basis for that quintessential British look. The twin set. A matching jersey and cardigan worn with pearls.
It's really a code of dressing that's actually incredibly hard to get right and incredibly hard to read. You either end up looking like, you know, a prim Sunday school teacher, or you can look like the most glamorous thing that's wafted in from the continent. And Chanel sort of played with those extremes, I think, and it's a look that British aristocratic women are very good at pulling off.
1930s, the British had started to lead a more active lifestyle, having discovered the health benefits of the great outdoors and the sun.
You get a new enjoyment of the body and of exercise. So people are getting outside, they're stripping off. So all of those thin, fine yarn undergarments suddenly become outer garments. And there's something about the pleasure of wearing light layers that knitwear gives.
Casual sportswear was now such big business that even traditional underwear companies broadened their range to make fine knitted tops and leisure wear. Knits were everywhere, even at the beach, where the epitome of style was a knitted bathing costume.
This specially woven bathing suit is the very latest for the beach and has marvellous sea and sun resisting properties.
What's it made of?
Wool, if you must know, wool. You know, sheep's hair.
I say, doesn't he knit fast?
Quite.
Everybody really was wearing them who went to the beach. It was an extremely popular pastime. Swimming as well as all other sports had become a hugely fashionable thing to do. And of course, for ladies, they wanted to still look glamorous when they went to the beach. They were all very fitted and all built with what is called negative ease, which meant they were all supposed to be smaller than the person who was wearing them, so they were very tight and clingy.
Lots of women knitted their own swimsuits in the 1930s. Using an old pattern from the time, Susan has recreated one of those original costumes.
Here was is a swimsuit from 1932, and it's known as Call of the Sea. The shorts that are built in, and then it has a skirt over the top, and then it has just these little built-in straps, and it's got a seagull on the front. The biggest problem that we're aware of with these knitted swimsuits of the time is the thing that everybody knows about, which is the idea that when you go in the water and you immerse your swimsuit in the water is that the swimsuit does not stay on your body. It sinks from your body and holds all the water so that when you try and come out the water, your swimsuit doesn't want to come out with you. And so today I've got a model friend of mine, Fleur, who's a very brave young lady, and she's going to try on this swimsuit, and she's actually going to go into the sea behind us, and we're going to see what happens to the swimming costume when she comes back out the water.
Not too bad. Not a lot of support in this area, but I think I could have lived in the 1930s. You know, definitely wouldn't have stopped me going to the beach.
The 1930s knitted swimming costume is probably the most glamorous swimming costume that you can wear, and I, for one, think we should bring them back.
But the carefree days of holidays and leisure were drawing to a close. Now knitting would move from popular fashion to basic survival.
Mm-hmm.
From the earliest days of the Second World War, knitting would become an obsessive occupation through the dark hours of hardship and bombing raids. In long-standing community clubs, there are people who remember those days only too well. These women knitted during the war as teenagers and haven't stopped since.
Oh dear, oh dear, oh dear.
Dot Bradnam was first taught to knit age 6 and is still at it more than 8 decades later.
Well, apart from anything else, it's lovely to see something grow. I did that, I can have that, so-and-so can wear that, you know. I used to love it. And I used to be able to do it an awful lot quicker.
It's nice knitting when you've got a nice colour. Makes a difference.
Penny Gabb remembers knitting during the war at home with her mother and sisters.
I used to knit in the dining room, all crouched around the electric fire in warm, and we used to have the, maybe have had the wireless on at the same time, in the round table, and we just knitted and got giggled and knitted and giggled some more, and we all sat so close to the heat of the fire as we could, so the front of our legs was always bright red and burns and backs were so cold. It was very cold in the war, very, very cold.
I think knitting was vitally important during the Second World War. It was a really sort of important recreation. So if you were spending hours on end at night in an air raid shelter or in your home with a blackout, not a great deal to do, you couldn't really go out as such. So I think it was a very important thing to do to keep, you know, to keep yourself occupied, really, and was a sort of a social activity as well.
Knitting was vital for the troops. They needed lots of warm woolen clothes, and hard-pressed factories couldn't keep up with demand. So women and children knitted them so-called woolen comforts of every kind.
Oh, Lord, yes. I can remember Mum teaching me to do socks. We'd sit and do socks, and that was quite fun. Oh, no, we did knit masses of socks.
Bad cover helmets, gloves, gloves, socks galore. Masses of them and scarves. I nearly forgot the scarves. Terribly monotonous. Soul destroying.
Knitting for the troops got so huge that people from every walk of life joined in.
Twice a week, the Queen joins the ladies in the blue drawing room of Buckingham Palace to work for the Red Cross or do knitting for the troops. There's a complete absence of formality. It's just a job to be done, an example to us all of the way to win a war.
There was a real sense that everybody wanted to feel that they were doing their bit and really helping the war effort. And knitters were a big part of that because knitting, whether for the troops and knitting comforts or knitting for your own family, you're still doing your bit and really helping Britain.
Soldiers too were taught how to knit. And it came in especially handy when they were captured by the Germans. An extraordinary collection of jumpers still survives in the Imperial War Museum, hand-knitted by British prisoners of war.
This jumper is made by a prisoner of war called Ronald Eastman, and one of the things we know about him is that he was a handicraft teacher before the war, so probably knitting was something that he was already skilled at. It does look like it's been very well made. It's got a different stitching around the collar. It does look a very nice jumper to wear. The other thing we know about him is that because he was skilled in all sorts of craft activities, he was actually used for forging German documents in the camp, which were used in escape attempts, so he was obviously a very skilled individual. This jumper again looks like it's been made out of scraps of different bits of wool because the colour varies. The sleeves have got these different coloured bits at the shoulders and down the arms. It's also possibly been made by a prisoner whose knitting skills weren't up to the level of some of the others because it's a little bit uneven in that one of the arms is a little bit longer than the other. This jumper has been made by a prisoner of war called James Graham, and we know that this jumper was actually made by using a pair of homemade needles. He made them out of a Red Cross box, but it's obviously still managed a very skillful job of it despite using improvised materials and equipment. All of the jumpers look like they'd be really nice to wear. They look like they'd be very warm. And I'm amazed by the level of detail that's gone into them, the different designs, like the stripes on this one, the cable knit on the one over there. I'm always impressed by anything that's been made by prisoners of war. They showed such ingenuity and skill, and often in very difficult conditions with only improvised equipment.
As the war dragged on, the wool supply in Britain virtually dried up. So the government introduced the Make Do and Mend campaign to ensure clothes had a longer life. The greatest enemy in this particular battle wasn't the Nazi bomber, but the moth.
The eggs have hatched and they've started chewing their way through tweed and twill, worsted and wool. But stop! You can still win. Get busy at once. Let the air in. Let the light in. Brush your clothes. Shake them. Beat them. Hang them out in the sun.
People were also told to recycle their old wool.
When a knitted garment wore out, you just pull the whole thing apart, use the sit, pull it apart, and wind it into a skein.
Wash it and wrap it round the ball while it was absolutely wet.
And sort of hung it till it dripped dry.
Then it had knitted all up again. We had to recycle it.
I can remember sitting with Mum like this. All the bits that were all right were used again. I'd forgotten that.
Lots and lots of bits and pieces were reused. So two-colour knitting, for example, came back big style. Things like Fair Isle were very popular because it only involved different small amounts of different colours of wool. Sweaters got shorter and tighter because, of course, you were re-knitting a lot. So you didn't have quite the same amount of yarn as you might have done.
When the war finally came to an end in May 1945, relief and joy were universal. The country was in a mood for change. The newly elected Labour government promised comfortable new homes and free healthcare for everyone. Women now put war work behind them and focused on the home. The post-war years brought a baby boom, and who better to knit for than your little one?
There was a real move towards domesticity and a focus on the family. And knitting, of course, is very much about love and nurturing and protecting. So ultimately, knitting became something that demonstrated, firstly, housewifery skills, but also demonstrated how good a mother you were going to be.
In a time of austerity and rationing, the art of making baby clothes would reach new exalted heights.
This is a small selection of matinee jackets and cardigans. They're very beautifully made, these cardigans. They're very fine. They require special skill to do the fancy patterns and the edgings and so on. So they're really a labour of love, I suppose. This one is particularly fine because it has the little bits of embroidery here and the little lace motifs. A little smocking detail here, which is rather nice and gives it its fullness. And knitted in very fine yarn. You know, it would take a long time to knit something like this on very fine needles. And this little group is some toys from the 1950s. And this is what women would have done with leftover scraps of yarn or dounces and so on. And it was a way of both using up that wool and providing children with playthings, of course. This little doll has the most gorgeous knitted outfit, which is beautifully, beautifully made with a little dress and a little coat, two little tiny booties, and then even a little knitted pants and vest.
There was no end to women's ingenuity with odd scraps of wool, especially when it came to making presents for family and friends. Women could buy patterns to knit fancy cozies for the teapot in every design imaginable, to adorn bathroom items, the husband's golf clubs, not to mention the family dog. There was even an elaborate knit for your favourite tipple.
Ah, the knitted poodle cover is one of the icons of the 1950s. It's a very beautiful and delicate object which is intended to go over a bottle of alcohol. And it ties in with the idea of exotic holidays, predominantly American culture and, you know, those Elvis Presley movies and the Hawaiian shirts and all of that kind of exoticism that one wouldn't normally see in the UK.
If you weren't sufficiently skilled to knit a baby bonnet or a tea cosy, help was at hand. For this was the golden age of the women's magazine.
I think the magazines were important to women of the time because they reflected this sense that being a housewife was a proper job. It wasn't something that they did just as a leisure activity. It showed them how to clean properly, how to look after the family. Lots of articles about what to do if you're worried about your children, and recipes and things that made them feel part of a club. All the magazines had a sewing page and they had a knitting page. And judging from the number of magazines that I've found that have had the knitting pages torn out of them, it appears that knitting was very important. This is Woman's Own from Thursday, September the 15th, 1955. And if we turn to the knitting pattern that's about halfway through past some fictional stories, some romance, we get to plain and patterned. And this is a picture of a very complicated looking pink jumper. Apparently it's easy to knit. It has an open work medallion pattern, which is worked on the front of the jumper only.
and the back is worked in an unusual rib design. So it's really quite complicated. The insert picture shows a girl wearing it, having made it, and there's a man on a telephone who is ogling the young lady. But certainly the jumper seems to have struck the mark somewhere. In terms of knitting for your man, there are the classic sort of chunky knits, but also some waistcoats, which look absolutely horrendous, I have to say, and socks, which have very complicated patterns. So again, it really shows the skill that these women were expected to have.
New automatic home knitting machines promised a new age of convenience. But it wasn't always that simple.
It looks easy, but actually it's very technically difficult. The yarn has to be hooked onto each piece. Also, it's very labour-intensive because it's like doing vicious ironing. So it's like this, and it's very wearing. And although people said you could make a dress in 85 minutes, I think anybody would be hard-pressed to do that. I think a lot of knitting machines were probably given as gifts by husbands to wives, and I imagine that most of them weren't opened and remained in their boxes.
Even without the aid of a newfangled machine, women were reaching ever higher levels of sophistication in their knitting. A small book from the time gives a tantalising glimpse into the skill of the 50s housewife at her craft.
This is really an amazing book of stitches, stitch patterns, and there's a huge range of them, and they're absolutely fantastic. This page has got three samples on. The first one is a cloud souffle stitch, which I think is rather a nice name. And this is called candlelight stitch. So this is quite an intricate stitch, which actually you can see there's a lot of decreasings and increasings within the pattern to make sort of leafy shapes, and I suppose it's like candle flames. But then the other half of the swatch shows that it's also been beaded, and that would mean beads were threaded in, because they would always knit the beads in. They don't sew them on top, so that they have to be threaded onto the yarn and then pulled up at the right place. All of these would be complicated and also time-consuming to achieve. So they were working at the highest level.
But the gentle domesticity of the 1950s was about to be shattered. Now, knitwear would get sex appeal.
This is one of the Beatles' very first TV appearances for Granada Television. It's 1963, and they've recorded their debut album, and they are a band on the way out. They are wowing audiences all over England, and this is one of the first times that Britain as a country has been sat down and seen this group that they're starting to hear quite a lot about. And the fact that for this very important show, they are wearing black roll neck sweaters means that thousands and thousands of young people will yearn to look like John, Paul, George and Ringo, and to do so they will go out and buy roll neck sweaters. Beatle fans picked up on the roll neck very quickly, and you can see the popularity of this and how clever they were, because they started a fan club, fanzine out, called Beatle Monthly, which was growing at an incredible pace. And the first thing that they offer to their fans to buy is a roll neck sweater with a little inscription with the Beatles on. It was in one size, so that, you know, all girls, you know, could wear it, and boys could as well. it's just very significant that that is the first thing that they're offering their fans, you know, a roll neck sweater. Just as the Beatle boot was associated with the band, the Beatle haircut, so the roll neck sweater was. And sales would have soared, absolutely soared. If you were manufacturing roll neck sweaters in 1963, you had a very good Christmas.
And it wasn't just the Beatles.
The characters who tended to wear the roll neck sweater were kind of anti-heroes, such as Steve McQueen and Bullitt. They were cool, as in Steve McQueen and Bullitt, and he was somebody who was using the roll neck sweater to disassociate himself from the past, from the tie and the shirt and the suit. You know, that was gone now. Now we had a younger, new model, cool, reserved, anti-hero, intelligent, and of course, devastatingly attractive to women. He doesn't say a lot in Bullitt. You know, people in roll neck sweaters don't say a lot, you know. They let their jumper do the talking.
And if men had the roll neck, women had the sweater dress, a virtual uniform for young girls in the 60s. The look was finished off with a pair of long knitted socks or patterned tights. And queen of the 60s mini dress was designer Mary Quant.
She was very aware of the possibilities of jersey and knit and often incorporated knit in her designs. For example, we have this fantastic dress in the V&A collection, which is a mixture of a woven fabric, but also it has wonderful hand-knitted sleeves and a patterned neckline.
The 60s was a time of liberation, with people embracing exciting new fabrics and man-made synthetics. And that went for knitwear too.
The introduction of synthetic knits and textiles in the 1960s are incredibly important. And I think one of the big challenges with knits that we all might be familiar with is that they're very difficult to wash and that they take ages to dry. With synthetic knits, of course, you can now buy cheap, washable, durable knitted garments that last much longer. And it allows, for example, lurex or elastic to be knitted into the fabric and to produce a much more figure-hugging, shiny, patterned, brightly coloured sense of knit that's far sexier, far more clinging, and far more visually startling. This, of course, is the era when new forms of dance and the introduction of the disco allow knitwear to take on a new role, to take on a new image.
Creativity knew no bounds. And now, knitwear would become art.
These are art sweaters by Ritva. And Ritva was a label that was established in 1966 by Ritva Ross and her husband Mike Ross. And subsequently, they produced this line of art sweaters. Each of the sweaters are made by different artists. This one is by Elizabeth Frink. And as you can see on the label, it says 100% acrylic, which today is obviously not a covetable material as such, but at the time, acrylic was a great new fabric and people were really interested in the fact that it had a washable property. This sweater here is by David Hockney. And of course, at the time, he's known for his paintings of California, these wonderful blue skies and a lovely palm tree in the center. This is by Alan Jones, an artist who's known for his sculpture and furniture featuring figures of women, and also his reference to bondage and sadomasochism. This features a leather-clad boot, which comes out of a spiral central motif. Each sweater came as a limited edition and had the limited number worked into it, and also came presented with a perspex box that they could be placed in and then hung on the wall.
There was one particular artist who treated knitting like painting, as a canvas to experiment with colour. Kay Fassett. An American-born male model and artist, Fassett had moved to Britain in the 60s. He was first inspired to take up knitting by the colours of the Scottish landscape.
As I was travelling across Scotland for the first time, it was such an ancient palette, and I thought, here are these beautiful colours. So I grabbed 20 colours, jumped on a train, asked a woman sitting across from me, do you know how to knit? And she said, yes. And I said, I've got a sweater I've got to make. And I just started to knit on that train. Well, this is the very first garment, and it has all the colours of that Scottish landscape, as you can see, beautiful colours. I love looking at it again, just that little height of pink there. And then, of course, my knitting with all the ends hanging out, because I absolutely didn't know how to do those in. That sort of tells the story of how amateur I was.
Fassett would hit the big times working with top fashion designer Bill Gibb. The look was bohemian romance for the hippie age, with knitwear in complex colour patterns.
Probably the average that I put into a design of knitting, it would be about 25 to 35 colours, but I have gone up to 200 colours. The shape of the garment never interested me that much. You know, I was painting a painting. I was doing a fantastic poem of colour, a tapestry. One of the things that people often say about me is that I'm not interested in fancy stitches, which I am totally not. I let all of the fanciness happen with the colour changes. The back, I think, shows the design a little better. So you get these great big sleeves and this kind of very highly patterned yoke. You know, it's often asked to me, why is color important to you? As if it's kind of some strange, freaky thing. And it just astounds me. It's kind of like saying, well, why is breath so important to you? Why do you have to breathe? To me, it's air. It's the air of my soul.
Now, it didn't matter how you knitted or what you knitted. As long as it was colourful and expressive, anything went. Knitted outfits that covered the wearer head to toe in ethnic-style patterned fabric became the height of glamorous fashion. The catwalk was awash with draped knits in bold patterns, flaunted by top models like Jerry Hall. Knitting now was all about letting your imagination run away. Even wool had got wild and wacky. It was goodbye to bog-standard straight yarn, and hello to bright colours, fluffy mohair, textured yarn with bobbles, and super chunky. There was even a new tool to knit with.
Here, we've got what I might call broomsticks. And this is a sort of fast and chunky knitting that was really became popular in the 60s and 70s. People really wanted to knit something in an evening, and they could do that when they would knit not just with thick yarn, but they'd actually work with several yarns at once, and they had special knitting patterns specifically written for this.
In the mid-70s, knitting would reach its peak of rebellion, embraced by a most unlikely section of society. The punk.
In the mid-1970s, Malcolm McLaren and Vivian Westwood were driving forward a new punk aesthetic, which was really ripping up all that the 60s had represented. Punk costume and punk outfits were all about deconstruction. They were about pulling things apart. So suddenly it was okay to drop a line in your knitting and to have jumpers with huge holes in them, to look as if you'd been out all night in a fight, to shock and to challenge people through the fact that your clothing was half finished or half hanging off the body.
But a new era beckoned. Sharp suits and padded shoulders would take over Britain and deal a fatal blow to knitwear. After all, you'd never catch Mrs. T in a woolly sweater.
You know, styles do change, even if you think they don't. Shoulders are wider and they're higher.
In the 1980s, I think there is something of a decline in the role knitwear plays. There's a real shift towards a much more structured, tailored body. It's all about shoulder pads and tight tailoring. And I think that sense of amateur production and craft in the decade of design, the decade of sharpness, is less prominent.
But for one last glorious moment, knitwear would be king. And it was all thanks to television.
It's breakfast time. It's 6:30 on Friday, December the 9th. A very good morning to you.
The subject of sweaters looms very large in the programme this
breakfast
morning.
Breakfast television was a brand new format that combined news items with informal chat.
Over the UK there, a lot of cloud, you can see.
And this spawned a whole array of novelty sweaters in funky designs. No one was better known for wearing loud, colourful knitwear on daytime telly than Giles Brandreth. He boasted a different sweater for every occasion. Giles still keeps some of his old favourites down in his basement.
Well, there you are. These two boxes contain all that is left of my once completely wonderful collection of knitwear. Once upon a time, I had more than 1,000 colourful jumpers. Some of them hand-knitted, some of them machine-knitted, some of them knitted by members of the public, some of them knitted by a man who only knitted jumpers for me, Elton John, and Diana, Princess of Wales. It was a glorious collection of knitwear, much loved by me, much derided by some. So I'm going to open the box now. Up we come, and let's see what we've got. Oh. Well, I'm not sure about what we're going to start with. Let's just open them and see. It's a pig. Why did I keep this one? I'm not sure. Oh. Now you're diddling. Now you're diddling. Look at this. And the texture here. Look at the wool. mohair. It's lovely mohair. Oh, look, here's another mohairy one. This I rather like, a penguin. And also, I had little tank tops. Simply with my signature on.
Why didn't the lemon gag not work?
Because you didn't do it properly. The idea with the lemon is you've got to really suck, suck, suck. Now, this is a jumper created by a viewer. And, well, this is original. It's got appliqued birds and bees attached to it. It's made by Karen Myers. Karen Myers, congratulations, Karen. Excuse me. I wore this during my Mick Jagger phase. Everyone goes through it. And look at this. Talk about Jack Flash. Oh, well, there you are. State it like it is. What does this say? The amazing, dashingly handsome, elegant, debonair Giles. This certainly wasn't one I designed myself. It must have been sent in by an admirer. Oh, look, Christmas is coming. I had so many Christmas jumpers, but this, I think, was perhaps my favourite because it's three-dimensional. And as I remember, if you unwrap these parcels, inside are little miniature jumpers.
Hey, very happy Christmas if we miss you between now and Sunday. We hope that you'll have a terrific time. Now, earlier this morning,
the novelty sweater or cardigan is a particular favourite for television presenters for a whole variety of reasons. It really shows the TV presenter as being actually a cuddly person. They're not formal or stuffy. There's no suit, there's no jacket, there's no tie.
It is. Good old Johnny Jarvis.
It suggests that they're somebody who's fun, with a good sense of humour, that would be great to have round for coffee, perhaps like a next-door neighbour.
Look, isn't it absolutely stunning?
But in a world of power dressing, even television presenters couldn't keep the knitwear dream alive. By the end of the 80s, knitwear had all but disappeared from our wardrobes. And the golden days of knitting were over. But now, something has happened. Wool shops have started popping up across Britain. And that can mean only one thing. Knitting is back.
Today has so many different people involved in it. We spend lots of time typing and sending things virtually, but we don't connect with things. So this idea that you can make something from basically nothing is quite appealing to people now.
There'll always be that room for a textile that is malleable, that is soft, that is comforting, but also flows across the body and can be extremely stylish.
Probably everything that's gone wrong with the world came about with the decline of knitting. And now that knitting's back, maybe everything's going to be good again. Oh, I do hope so.
Donate all your money, we'll make it better.